7 years ago, my family arranged for me to marry a man I hadn't met. A man who spoke little English. A man who was my first cousin. And now my family have plans to marry off my younger brother, Gark.
I don't know, man. I don't know. I just don't think it's for me.
DAB Digital Radio.
Your sound across the UK.
BBC Asian Network.
It's 10 o'clock. This is NEILA Butt. A man who ran down a pedestrian in a feud sparked by an arranged marriage has had his bid to overturn his conviction dismissed. London's appeal court.
I grew up with the idea that my marriage would be arranged. So when it was decided I was going to marry my first cousin, that was fine by me. In fact, it's estimated that more than 50% of British Pakistanis do marry their first cousins, which may seem shocking, but it's completely normal to us. A lot of people think it's illegal. It's not. But I found that non-Pakistanis are often appalled by the idea, especially my best friend Claire.
It was shocking. It was hugely shocking for me, coming from my background. And then I knew you for so long. You're such, so strong, so dynamic. And I was like, God, what is she doing? And it took me a long time to understand, you know, where you were coming from.
It's just, it's the first port of call almost for when you get married. You know, you couldn't find somebody better to marry than in the family. And if there's somebody available, it's almost silly not to take up the opportunity. I know it sounds like a job application or taking the best job.
Sounds like a dating agency with a family run it, you know.
Watching my wedding video brought up a whole load of memories for Claire and me.
You remember you came over from Dublin?
To try and stop you. I was going to take you back, wasn't I, with me? I was like, please come back to Dublin, you'll be safe and no one will get you.
But you got really upset and I was really touched that you got that upset. But you even said to me, look, here's a ticket, NEILA.
I suppose I thought from an outside point of view that you'd been forced upon you.
Because that wasn't true. I wasn't forced at all. I think also what was quite horrifying for you was that I hadn't met him. That was quite difficult for you to comprehend.
Yeah, very difficult. And to this day, I'd still find that difficult.
Things have gone well for me, but I think Claire puts this down to luck. She can't seem to get her head around the idea of marrying in the family. That makes me wonder, why do we see things so differently? What's the reality? Is our tradition of cousin marriage really a recipe for success or disaster? I decided to look into it. I've been happily married to Farooq for 7 years now, and our son Daanish is 6 years old.
You okay? You have any... What did you do today?
I didn't do it. I don't remember.
Oh.
In Pakistan, Farooq was a lawyer, but here he's had to take a job as a police interpreter.
Mama.
Hello.
Oh, Daanish. Oh, Daanish is there.
Assalamu alaikum.
My daughter Hikmah is almost two.
Assalamu alaikum.
All right, Daano. Did you have a nice day? Little day. A happy meal. Are we going to have a happy meal? You want to go to Dada. All right, Mikiti.
I find that the reason you and I get on so well, or, you know, that our marriage has worked, is because of the basic things in our family, the basic kind of upbringing, the basic personalities are actually the same, which that helps the compatibility, which is, I think, why people still want to have the cousin marriage.
Yeah, that's right as well, but the thing is, the other thing between us is that I really love you.
We're held up by the wider family, me and Farooq, as a shining example of how well a cousin marriage can work. I'm one of five brothers and sisters. The eldest is Ghazala, who's been married now for 6 years. Also within the family.
I'm married to paternal uncle's wife's first cousin. So figure that one out. I'm married to sort of a second cousin. When we were younger, and you know when you're at school and you're Asian or you're the odd one out, people used to think, oh, you marry cousins, that's weird. But there's nothing, I mean, my mum and dad were, I think they're first or second cousins. And, you know, there's nothing strange about it because it's allowed, it's something that we're allowed to do.
Actually, our parents were first cousins and their marriage was a very successful one. Sadly, my dad passed away 12 years ago, and lately Mum's had some quite serious health problems, but she's always been very much at the heart of our family life.
We haven't seen you for days.
I know. Nani-ji. Give Nani-ji appa.
Nabs, my younger sister, has given up her job to look after Mum full-time. She's 31 and still single.
But, yeah, it would be nice if Nabs got married. Hmm? It would be nice if Nabs got married. It's about time.
Before I get my pension.
Before you get your pension, yeah. Before we all get our pension.
Yeah. Nabs might joke about it, but for most Pakistani parents, getting your children suitably married has always been a worry. Traditionally, if you're marrying off your daughter, you have to pay out a dowry. But if you marry your cousin, like I did, no dowry is normally expected. Also, marrying your daughter within the family means you know she'll be safe. Will you be there? Someone to share my life. Will you be there? Through the days and the nights. Will you be there? I love to call my own.
Will you be there? On my nights alone. Where is Daanish? You okay?
I loved the idea of marrying Farooq. It felt like a way of strengthening the links with all our relatives back home in Pakistan. That's one reason my family's chosen a girl from Pakistan for my brother Gark. For the past 4 years now, a marriage has been planned between him and our cousin Isma.
Hello! I'll see you in a bit.
He's lovely, my brother. And although he's 30, he's the baby of the family. He likes to think of himself as a bit of a wheeler-dealer. But he's been successful, investing in a number of different shops and restaurants.
We're going to put you stairs then?
The only problem with Gark is that he's hard to pin down and he likes to play his cards close to his chest.
How are you, Governor?
All right. Come say goodbye, man.
I know, man. I heard.
Yeah.
I heard you're leaving us.
I'm going to Pakistan.
Honestly.
Is it going to be you and your family? Or?
My mum, my sister and me. And they want me to...
Hey, you're going to have a great time.
How long are you staying here?
They're going to stay for about 4 weeks.
Mm-hmm. Honestly?
Yeah.
Bring us some presents back.
For 4 weeks, brother. Nah.
Bring some presents back. And a wife.
Yeah, that's what I think that's what they went for.
I think so.
But I think, nah.
Yeah, man.
Okay.
There is this thing that they're saying, go back home, get married, have a look at a girl. And I'm saying, look, it's not really going to happen.
We'll take it from there. Okay, see you later. I'll take all
that. It looks a bit like Gark is having second thoughts. Maybe he's thinking of following in our older brother's footsteps. Masood is married, but to an English girl. He's been head of the family since my dad passed away. When the family get together at the end of Ramadan, it's a good opportunity to get the men's views on cousin marriages.
There you go, chocolates. What do you think the benefits are then?
The main one is mum, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because if somebody comes from within the family, and obviously she's going to look after mum, then, you know, it's a different scenario from somebody who comes outside, isn't it? A bit easier. Because, you know, they've grown up, haven't they? They know they know the situation. I'm not saying people from outside are, like, horrible, but, you know, if you're going to get an advantage, take it.
Saying that, then, if it's going to say...
Choosing a favourite niece for their son means parents can be sure they'll be looked after in their old age by someone they both know and like. As a new wife, usually moves in with her in-laws.
My personal opinion is that, you know, sometimes you need to listen to your elders, really, because it's not like you know everything about everything, is it? And the most important thing is the people who are making the decision,
yeah,
they're not going to do it to mess him up, are they?
Yeah, that's it. Well, you know, this is it, isn't it?
Nobody has an arranged marriage and tries to mess the people up who are getting married.
Yeah, people get to that stage when they do actually finally get to arrange. It's because they've tried everything else, all the other fish in the water, and they can't find somebody that's suitable to them or to their family or whatever. So possibly that's when you think, right, OK, I might as well go and see what Mum and Dad have got for me.
I mean, I met my husband twice before we got married. And it was, hello, would you like a cup of tea? And that was it. And by that time, I'd got so tired of saying, no, I don't want to get married, full stop. I just said, yes, you know what, let's just do it and get it over with. And as it worked, as it happened, it worked out OK.
With the tickets booked for Pakistan and only 2 weeks to go, we've got to get our act together.
The sun's really nice, Nyla. Look, it's bright, it's deep, deep red.
You should always be red. On the wedding day, it should be red.
I'm getting these three. You can have one of these.
Are you getting three pink ones? No. Don't get three pink rings, that's what I'm saying. Look at this one.
I like these.
It's lovely as well.
That's beautiful.
I've got green.
No, don't get that one. Get this one. I don't like that nug in the middle. See what? Don't.
Since Nabs is the bossy one, we've all agreed she should be in charge of the wedding plans.
I think you should get a long one like that.
No, no, I prefer real diamonds. I don't like the shiny ones.
The girl Kark is going to marry is our 24-year-old cousin Isma. Kark has never met her. Maybe this explains why he's getting cold feet.
I want to say to Kark, look, this is the girl, get to know her, talk to her, see if you're on the same wavelength, because that's what it's about.
And
it's
how are you going to do that?
Kark hasn't been to Pakistan since he was five. Mm-hmm. And when he goes there and he meets the family, he's going to see what an extended family is about.
We went,
and he's going to, like, when we went for the first time and we were overwhelmed with it and we couldn't believe the way we were treated, and he's going to really... He's going to be amazed that he's treated like that.
I've already told my family, arranged marriages and that aren't really a problem, but when you marry within the family, sometimes it's just... It's just proving more and more, as times change, it's just proving more and more difficult for it to be a success.
I know he does feel overpowered or...
I know he does, like, but I say to him all the time that, listen, Kark, even if you feel like that, you shouldn't close yourself off, because you know what? You might get there, I might think, you know what?
Yeah.
I can't believe this girl, and I can't believe
her.
I said, you shouldn't close yourself off and go there with a narrow... Not a narrow mind, but just that
close
in your heart.
Mind, yeah.
Forget everything. Forget what everybody says. You go there, you make your own opinions, because you're a 30-year-old male, you're a man now. You can make your own opinions.
But the problem is, these lot have, in some way... arranged some kind of commitment or had a word with somebody there. So I've said to my mum, if you have, I will turn around and say no.
I had a very different attitude to my brother, but maybe most young British Pakistanis see things the same way as him. I'm off to meet a group of students at my old college. I want to see what they think about cousin marriages.
It's a bit weird, really, isn't it? I mean, if you know your cousins, you see them as, you know, your brothers and sisters. I think it'd be hard to see them as, you know, someone you can love as a partner, as opposed to, say, brothers and sisters, brother sisterly love. It'd be a bit weird.
So would you marry a cousin from Pakistan?
I mean, if you do have a cousin that's quite distant and you don't know them well, then it might be all right. Might be. Can I stress the might?
Look at it scientifically as well. There are, if you get, like, if there's loads of inter-cousin marriages, there are chances that your children be abnormal, so you don't...
Does that, that's what I was going to come on to, the medical side of things, because there is research now that says there is the possibility that there may be a genetic problem with children.
Thalassemia.
Does that, and does that put you off in any way?
It did. It put me off.
Nobody wants abnormal children.
Yeah.
That's why I wouldn't want to marry my cousin. Pretty much the reason. Don't want to take risks and
but then
unnecessary
there's
risks.
There's tests and things that you can do. You know, would if that was available, would you have a test before?
I dare not suggest that to our parents. They'll be like, you're just complicating things, and then...
Because it doesn't happen in our culture. I mean, like, you know, they think they consider these sort of things as, like, you know, something that's bad. You're having, you know, if you go, oh, Mom, I want to test before I get married.
Yeah, it's what you're on about. Seen as disrespectful.
What if you explained it to them that these are the reasons why? And
can't ask them, can I have a test before I get married? Because they'll just look at you and think, what are you talking about?
I was quite surprised to find that although most of them were against cousin marriages and aware of the genetic risks, they'd still marry in the family if that's what their parents chose for them. I wonder if they'd see things differently if they had a serious disability in the family. Myra is 17 and she's got an incurable genetic skin disorder called epidermolysis bullosa, known as EB, which causes her skin to blister and means she's often in a lot of pain. Myra's parents were first cousins. She was born in this country, but when she was just 3 months old, her parents returned to Pakistan. Myra stayed on for medical treatment and was adopted by her uncle Zahir's family.
How was your day today, Myra?
It was all right.
Billy's happy to see you.
Can Myra? So he knows Myra's actually, you know, very fragile. So he'll never, like, whack anything on her or... He always takes care of Myra.
Is Myra? You sit there wondering, have we done something wrong? Mm-hmm. Have we done something that God's punishing us as a result? Mm-hmm. We were told that it was incurable and she won't get better. It's a genetic thing.
As Myra's mum is married to her cousin, I wanted to know whether her family accepted this could be the root of the problem.
As far as the family accepting it, I don't think we really fully accepted it at the time.
That this was a result of a first cousin marriage? That this is the reason?
Yeah, that the risk was increased as a result.
So what did they think it was? What did they say?
They believed it was probably a test from God. There was also an idea that someone might have done some black magic. Which is quite a common belief amongst the Asian, Pakistani at least, community. And there was always that element of not wanting to believe. We would prefer to just live in hope and prayer.
When Myra's mother had another baby with EB, they had to face up to the fact that the condition was genetic and linked with her marrying her first cousin.
In the context of Myra's family, both Myra's mum and Myra's father both carry the defective gene.
Right.
So there's a 1 in 4 chance of having an affected child.
Did she then think that if I'm going to have another child now, I'm definitely going to get tested? Did she make that decision?
Yeah. And unfortunately last year, she was pregnant again. And she did go ahead with the prenatal testing. And I found out that, yes, for the third time, the child was affected.
When Myra's mother found that the baby was affected, she sought religious guidance at home in Pakistan. Then, after taking medical advice, she decided to have the pregnancy terminated. But for Pakistani families, this is a pretty traumatic decision to have to make, challenging both our religious and cultural beliefs. Zahir also made a personal choice. He decided not to marry a cousin and married outside the family instead. So did his other brother and sister. It's clear that there are genetic risks associated with cousin marriages, but we've never had a problem in our family, so why does it affect some families and not others? I went to see consultant geneticist Tessa Humphrey to see if she could explain.
How more at risk are you if you have a cousin marriage in terms of having a baby, perhaps, or having health problems genetically?
The increased risk over that of the general population if there is no family history of any previous disease is of the order of 2-3%.
It's not that high, is it?
It's not enormous. But once there has been a child with a genetic condition within the family, then that risk goes up very considerably because, obviously, the genes remain within the family.
Well, that's what I was going to say. You really don't know whether you've got a problem until that problem occurs, really. Where does the risk actually begin to surface, if you like?
Well, I think that any family history is obviously very significant, but where both couples carry an abnormal gene, you may have a child with an abnormality. Now, we all have these abnormal recessive genes. We're all said to have 2-3 of them. But if you actually marry within the family, you're more likely to share these abnormal genes, and therefore you're more likely to get a double dose of the of this.
So it's when they come together, is absolutely, it, that you get the problem? And what about if you've had, if your parents before you, the generation before or the generation before, does that likelihood of you having a genetic problem also increase then if the if that cousin marriage continues through the generations?
It certainly does.
I'm finding it difficult to get my head around all this. But it seems the real risk comes when two cousins are both carriers of the same abnormal gene. Then the chance of the baby inheriting the genetic disorder leaps to 25%. This is 10 times the risk the average couple face. Now that is a worrying statistic. But it's good to hear that young Pakistani women are beginning to come forward for tests before embarking on a cousin marriage. Tessa Homfrey can advise them on what the risks are, so they can decide whether to go ahead with the marriage or not. So does this mean that cousin marriages are a mistake? No, I don't really think so, because at the end of the day, the risks for the vast majority of us aren't that great. I suspect, though, over time, the community will start basing their choices more on medical advice. But I don't think we'll completely break with a tradition that's been working for centuries. I think cousin marriages will be around for a while yet. With 1 week to go before we head off to Pakistan, my brother Gark seems to be keeping himself to himself, and he's avoiding talking about the wedding.
I got the money, let's go to the bullring, forget Pakistan.
I really hope he's not thinking of pulling out.
I've had numerous conversations with all family members individually, but I'm not answering up to when people ask me questions like, oh, are you going back home to get married? And I don't answer them. I just say, look, no, I'm going back home and I'm going to see what's happening. The reason I want to do this trip back home is because my dad's been passed away like 12 years now, and I'd like to go and see, you know, where my dad comes from, where we come from and who we are.
The family have been planning Gark's wedding for the past 4 years, but as the big day gets closer, I'm beginning to get worried that he's not really up for it. In fact, we're all getting worried, because we're not just Gark's sisters, we're also cousins to the bride.
The way our family is over there, the women generally don't go out to work. And so she hasn't had a career, she hasn't had an education. She's been sitting, waiting for her fiancé to come to Pakistan to get married. So her life has been on hold. And it's not fair on her for him to go and say, you know what, I'm not sure, let's just think about it. I don't know what I'm doing yet.
But there's no harm in having a look, is there? You could have a look. Now, it's entirely up to you whether you say yes or not.
Yeah, well, that's probably what's going to happen.
I would just suggest this.
But they already know. I've told a lot of them anyway.
There's plenty of them in this country, mate. You don't have to say yes from there.
You don't have to go yes back home.
Now, the problem starts once you're in that country.
Yeah.
You're in, and then you're under the stress of actually getting out of there.
Getting back out.
I've said to Gark that if he doesn't feel it's right, he's got to think about what the effect will be on my mum, because this is something she's been looking forward to through her illness for the last 2 or 3 years.
For me, the only thing I would say anything for is for my mum to keep her happy. Because at the end of the day, you know, they say heaven's at your mother's feet. But, you know, ultimately, a mother's wish is for her sons to be happy. But her son wants a mother to be happy, so you're in a kind of vicious circle, and that's where you got to get the common ground and compromise and say, right, where are we going to compromise here? Where are we both going to be suitably happy?
I'll either be there for the celebrations or for the fallout when the proverbial hits the fan.
I'm waiting for the AK-47s at the airport.
We've got more suitcases than seats.
If we're lucky, we'll miss the flight as well. There's our sis, look, the packer.
She's standing, can you see the arms on her hips, ready to make sure I get on the bloody plane?
Don't worry, man, that's not me.
Go on. You think I'm going to do a runner, man, holding my hand?
Finally, we're off. At the very last minute, Garg decided not to drive to the airport with us, but with some friends instead. He's meeting us there. We're there, but no sign of Garg.
You can check in, but they'd rather do it all together.
Where the hell is he?
Oh, shit.
Luckily, Garg did just catch that flight, much to my relief. And we're getting a great welcome. The Butt clan have turned out in force, about 60 of us in all. We're at my Uncle Prevez's house in Lahore, and everyone's getting excited by the idea of a wedding.
Actually, I'm quite impressed with it here. Family's lovely. I like everybody. Everybody's really nice. But I think when word gets out that I'm not intending here to come and get married, that's when I think it's going to go wrong.
At this stage, I didn't realise, maybe I didn't want to, how against this cousin marriage Garg was, nor did the others. So we kept going with the wedding arrangements. A ritual part of the build-up to a wedding in Pakistan is the maya, when the groom's family visit the bride's house. It's so good to see Isma at last. We paint her with turmeric paste, which is a traditional cleansing ritual. The spot on her nose signifies a bond. But the groom himself isn't here, and although this isn't particularly unusual, I do think Garg is choosing to keep his distance. What Garg is enjoying is retracing his father's footsteps. He's keen to see the house where our dad and Farooq's dad grew up together as brothers.
This is our house. It's not in a very well condition, but they built this house in 1930s. When I was about 3-4 years, I fell from this first building and they took me to the hospital. So this is our house.
I do understand why Garg wants to explore his past while he's here, but he's got to face the future too.
The only reason I'm getting frustrated is because I think that the time that he needs to use to get used to the girl is being used elsewhere. I think that's my actual point.
I don't think he needs to get used to the girl.
Or the idea of being with her.
The idea of being married.
Yeah.
Maybe.
He's got a really nice girl. He's got his family around.
Yeah, but it's a big step for the rest of your life, isn't it? So you can't bully him.
No, I don't think he's a bully.
No, I don't mean bully, but, you know, no, but you have to, everyone's different.
The main thing is, as long as it gets done. gets done because it has to be done. It gets done with Garth willingly.
Yeah, absolutely.
If us four say to Garth, you have to do this, he won't say no. But we don't want
to. I don't want to put him in that position. No. I wouldn't put any of us
Mom
in that position.
Mum doesn't want to do that.
No. Because that's not the way we are.
Willingly.
I'm not going to make him think like me. He's got to think for himself.
The clock's ticking.
It's one big road with a lot of signs, signs and more signs. You gotta make up your mind to face reality all the time. No, many a sorrow, many a joy. Never you try to take life for a toy. Some doing good and some doing bad. But these type of bad is driving me mad. But when the sun shines today, I go on my knees and I pray. I say, Lord, let me have joy. I say, Lord, let me have joy. Never let me have no sorrows.
At this point, although I didn't know it at the time, Garth told my Uncle Bervaires and some other members of the family that he really didn't want to go ahead with this wedding.
They all know. This is what the tension is now. I think, I don't know if my aunt's family have found out, but in that room, a lot of people know this guy does not want to get married here. But they're saying that it's very good for him. It's good for his future. It's good for the family. It's good for my mum. It's good for all of us. So why is he saying no?
It's been 4 years since Garth's been engaged to this girl. Yeah. And for a girl that's been engaged in Pakistan for 4 years, it's a very long time. And then to actually arrive here and then say, oh, sorry, we're not doing it, is actually quite a devastating blow. But, you know, my mum isn't even registering that. She's not even comprehending that that's going to happen, and nor is Nabs.
I'd like to be able to convince Garth it's the right thing to do in a way that makes him feel it really is right for him and her. I'm feeling quite down and sad, really. I do believe this marriage would work for him, but he doesn't seem to see it. And if he sticks to saying no, the implications are going to be horrendous. Isma, our cousin, will be seen as discarded goods and may well be unmarriageable. Her family will find it hard to forgive us.
They're putting me in a predicament where they're saying, you know, you have to realise the implications of doing it, the implications of not doing it. We won't ever probably come back here again. My mum probably is not going to be able to see her family again. I'm getting a lot of pressure in terms of her health, and I'll have to bear sole responsibility for her health. But there's a risk here of doing something that isn't likely to be a success, and maybe risking ruining a girl's life, and on top of that, she's somebody in the family. I don't want to do that.
Finally, my brother did choose to get married, something we thought might never happen. And I must say, I really did admire the way he handled it. In the end, the crunch came because of an unexpected twist of fate. My Uncle Bervaires had a heart attack and Garth was with him at the time.
My uncle, he had a heart attack. And, scary, man. Then the doctors came and they said, well, look, it was a build-up over the last couple of weeks to this, and you're very lucky to get to the hospital, because it wouldn't have made it.
Uncle Bervaires did pull through, but it left Garth quite traumatised.
He just had this sorry look, like, I'm sorry kind of thing, and I was like, look, you know, I'm the one who should be sorry here for putting you through this and everybody else. And I think that's when I decided that, you know what, it's not worth, you know, to sacrifice a happiness of my own or somebody else's in comparison to that of
family members who I'll never ever... it was just a bit too much, to be honest with you. And I think I decided that I'm not going to risk something happening to him or my mum. I kind of gave up the fight as such. And I gave in and I said, OK, look, go ahead with it. I don't think by doing something like this would make so many people happy. Every time I looked around, I just saw my uncles standing in the background and I thought, okay. You know, my mum was sitting there and it made me feel good that I've done something for all the family. But families are dangerous. Can't live with them and you can't live without them. You always have to put them first.
I'm full of respect for my brother. I know it hasn't been an easy ride, but I do think this marriage is right for him and for my mum. And for our cousin, too. Isma may look sad, but it's a tradition for the bride to keep her eyes lowered as this is her ritual leave-taking from her parents. But we're really looking forward to her coming home with Gark. I love my brother, and I do hope he'll be happy.
They all think it's for the best. Time will tell, though. That's what they say, inshallah. Everything happens for a reason. You know, there's a... the greatest scheme of things, as they say. Although it seems like it's the end of one thing, it's just the beginning of another.
You've been affected by any of the issues in tonight's programme and would like to talk to someone in confidence for further information and support, please call the BBC Action Line on 0800 092 20 21. Lines may be busy, so please remember that the Action Line is open 7 days a week from 7:30 a.m. until midnight. All calls are free and confidential.